Thank you. Just a few more minutes of science for you, but now a much more basic science. The view from neuroscience of why do some foods taste bad? Now, at the simplest level, at the level of the biologist, there is an easy answer, which is genetics. We've heard it a couple of times already today. Oh, I don't like that. It's hereditary. And so the biologists would have us believe, and most of us do believe, that genetics make sure that things that are potentially harmful in our environment, we don't like. But what I'm going to show you today is that, in fact, your social experience, and even the social experience of a rat, is not only a major player, it is the primary player in determining your basic likes and dislikes, or the rat's basic likes and dislikes. But first, the simple story actually is kind of compelling because some things just seem to taste good and some things taste bad. For instance, sweetness. Sweetness is good. And if you give something sweet to a rat, you will watch as the rat tells you how good it is. He's licking his lips. He's making what has been definitively scientifically shown to be the rat yum face. Contrast that to the same poor rat. If you put something bitter or sour on his tongue, instead you will get this yawning tongue out thing called a gape. There it is. That's the rat yuck face. That's a rat that's not happy about what it's eating. And then, of course, he tries to get away. Think it's just a rodent thing? Think again. Before we are trained that it's not something polite to do, we also gape and stick our tongue out when we've had something bitter or sour. Even animals that don't have much of a brain at all will do the same thing. Here is a Kalahari toad attempting to eat a very, very bitter bug. And that's a gape. So sweet things are yummy, and bitter things are yucky, and it makes perfect sense, because what is sweet out in the environment? It's things that are caloric and ripe. Things that have calories and are ripe are generally sweet, and so it makes sense that they would be pleasurable to us. And furthermore, it's only very recently in evolutionary history that we've had access to them. They, up until very recently, were hard to get. In the meantime, what's bitter? Well, a lot of environmental toxins taste bitter. And so it makes sense that bitterness would be something we didn't like because there's a high chance of it being a poison. So given this, you would expect that our genetics and biology would imbue us with the ability to determine the difference between these two things and act on them. And to an extent, you're correct. Now, first of all, what is not true is that different parts of your tongue are specialized for different tastes. This turns out to be completely wrong. Forget it. But if you look at an individual taste bud, you see something that amounts to the same thing. Each taste bud on the tongue is shaped a little bit like an orange. The cells in it are shaped like the wedges of the orange. And each one responds to different things in the environment. Something sweet in the environment very specifically activates a certain subset of those cells. Bitter things in the environment activate an entirely different subset of cells. So even at the beginning, bitter and sweet are separated so that they can travel different paths. And since those paths lead to the brain, it makes sense, almost inevitable sense, to think something bitter hits the tongue, it goes to the brain, and there is a genetic hardwired pathway that leads straight from that to get this the hell off my tongue. It's simple, it's elegant, it matches the data that I've presented, and it's demonstrably wrong. In fact, this is not what happens in the real world, because in the real world, experience is king. For instance, we're all aware of the fact that if you have a delightful evening with a particular taste, and later you get sick because of it, that the next day, that taste will have changed completely. What once was yummy is now horrible. Now, this learning, which is called conditioned taste aversion, we can do it in the lab with rats by pairing sugar water with a low-level emesis. It is as evolutionarily important as the basic responses to tastes themselves, because up until recently, we didn't have supermarkets. And so how were you supposed to know what to avoid? And the answer was, your taste system told you. Now, it seems kind of strange that the system would be both this flexible so that one taste experience could change it, and also hardwired. difficult to believe, but still possible. It could be that the experience follows the genetics logically. But then there's one other form of learning that we need to talk about, social learning. Notice that these two guys are drinking together. In fact, I'll bet you that the only reason that one of them thinks tequila tastes good is because the other one told him to. In fact, most of our taste experiences are learned. Our earliest taste experiences are learned from our parents. And lest you think, oh, but this is a human peculiarity, this doesn't tell us anything basic about taste, consider the fact that the same thing happens to rats. If you give a rat something to eat, and then that rat has an encounter with another rat, that second rat will smell his breath. And here's an example. Here are two rats in our experiments, and you'll see they go right to smelling each other's breath and then to smelling other parts of their anatomies. If you, after that, give that second rat an opportunity to choose, he will prefer the taste that the first rat had on his breath. This is true even if it was horribly bitter. In my lab, we use raw cocoa, which if you've ever put a piece of baker's chocolate in your mouth, is not pleasant. But once he's had this social experience, he likes it. And he's never tasted bitter before. We know because in our lab, we control their lives. He's never had a bitter taste. We know that even in the interaction, he didn't taste bitter because we can knock out his tongue with ambisol, and it still works. The very first time he gets bitter on his tongue, he likes it just because of this very ordinary social experience, which completely contradicts the biological model I gave you 2 minutes ago. Something bitter gets on the tongue, it goes to the brain, and what's built in, what's hardwired in, is a switch. And there might be a basic setting to the switch under ordinary conditions. If it's bitter, head to rejection. But the other choice is already built in. And why? How? And what decides what choice is made on that switch? It turns out that there's a great deal of the brain that plays into where that switch gets set. That's an entirely different talk. But the take-home message is, what do genetics do? They don't actually tell you what to do or what to feel. They are there to increase the flexibility and take advantage of the environment. Thank you very much.